My name is Clint Burson. I'm the Director of Government Affairs for the Chamber of Commerce. Before I introduce you to Paul and the panel, I just wanted to take a moment to thank our sponsors. First and foremost, First Interstate Bank, they're our title sponsor. They're a big reason why the state of Missoula workshops are happening. But we've also got sponsorships from Northwestern Energy, Anderson, and I can't pronounce the last name, so forgive me, Zermelin. I'd never get it right. And Market on Front, they're all sponsoring events so that you guys can be here and be a part of this and we can keep the cost reasonable. So I'd like to introduce Paul Gladen. He's with Blackstone Launchpad and he will be moderating the panel today, and I'll let you handle the other introductions.
Thank you very much. Good afternoon. Some of you heard this line before, but the accent is English, not Australian. It's generally impolite to tell an Englishman he sounds like an Australian. Anyway.
I was thinking Scottish, so thank God. Thank God you said something.
I've had just about everything. It's pretty bizarre, but anyway. So my role is to moderate, which is really to get these folks to do most of the talking. We'll definitely open it up to some Q&A. This is a pretty small group, so I suspect we can really take Q&A from the audience as we go through. So if you have a burning question, maybe related to something they've said, feel free to just jump in with that. So we'll do quickly just very brief introductions, so you know who all the panel are and kind of where they're, what their role is as a as an entrepreneur. All these folks are entrepreneurs in various stages, although Joel's also an attorney. We'll get them to talk a little bit about their kind of relationship to each other, which I'll explain, and we'll just start to talk about this mentoring process. What is it? How did they get into it? What do they get out of it? What are some of the do's and don'ts? And get into some of your questions. So that's the plan. So, John, do you just want to give us a brief introduction? Although most people hopefully have already.
Yeah, I don't know if I need to introduce myself again for the fourth. This will be the fourth introduction. But John Hagmer from now Commonwealth Growth Group. And really excited to be in Missoula, and look forward to this conversation.
I'm Nick Shantz. I'm a software developer, and I co-founded GeoFly. And by day, I still put in time at the University of Montana.
And I'm Joel Henry, and despite being a lawyer, I'm actually a pretty nice guy. Briefly, my background is that I was a computer science professor for 20-some years. And then I decided to go to law school, take my sabbatical and go to law school, which was a great idea until you actually do it. And then it's not so much fun. But anyway, I'm an attorney, and I'm a full-time attorney, and I focus on the startup and growth phase businesses, from corporate and transactional law through intellectual property. And I've been a mentee and a mentor, so I feel quite fortunate.
Can you give us like one line on the business you started as well?
Yeah, I started a business with the generic name Agile Data Solutions, but what it does is it uses natural language understanding to find evidence in large amounts of email and documents for attorneys and law firms. Because their problem used to be, gee, the client says, here's my email, and it was maybe that much, and they could put it in a binder. And now it's like that much, except it's all CDs. So it's like millions upon millions of emails with it, all kinds of attachments. And you just can't physically look through it. So that's what my business does.
That's totally true, by the way. Yeah. When we took on our investment, I had to go back and get something. They sent me a CD. And I couldn't find it. I was like, are you kidding me?
Nuts.
Yeah, that's a smart move. I started throwing it out there.
Yeah.
Yeah. Something I learned.
And it's amazing what you find in email. You tell people, don't put that in an email.
I'm learning.
Oh, yeah. Too, right? And then they put the stories I could tell.
So. I'm Stephanie. I'm very concerned about my email inbox right now. What did I say?
What did I write?
Right. Entrepreneur in Missoula. Me and my husband have four concepts and 12 businesses. coexist as entrepreneurs, and then I've also been very active in the kind of startup entrepreneur world in Montana, just in liking to be a part of helping people take that first step in what it means to be an entrepreneur and define it for themselves, and then go and get after it and get it done. So I live in that space.
Hey, Steph. I'm Matt Gangloff. I'm the founder of Enlightened Lab Float Center, which is a new spa coming into town which features sensory deprivation as wellness therapy. My experience in entrepreneurship in Missoula is basically based on being in the right place at the right time with most of these people. So happy to be here.
Cool. So we've essentially got two mentor-mentee kind of relationships here, and then John's going to share some of your own experience, some of which you've already done. Very insightfully in the last day or so already, but and I think one of the things we want to get out of this is kind of mentoring, coaching, consulting, lots of different ways in which people get advice and guidance from others, so is to explore that a little. But maybe we can have kind of Nick and Joel, maybe you can just talk a little bit about sort of how did your relationship sort of get started, and what does that relationship look like a little?
Sure. So I was once upon a time a computer science student, although I didn't ever have Joel as a professor. I think that's probably the first time we maybe met or were introduced. But I feel like our relationship is really organic. Doing work in IT, being part of computer science, we just sort of got to know each other. And then, you know, as my sort of career progressed at the university, Joel was someone that I could reach out to and just sort of bounce ideas off or if I was struggling with the politics of the university, he was someone that could at the very least commiserate or maybe help me sort of steer those waters. And then as my partner and I started GeoFly as a business, Joel had sort of started his business and been successful there and had sort of good wisdom for us from a legal perspective as well. The last thing I'll say is I think there's probably, we've been in business for about 2 years, and I think there's sort of two, maybe three moments where people gave us like real, honest truth answers, and Joel was the first of those that kind of made sure we were on the right point in the right direction.
Mm-hmm. And I think my role in this was more of having been mentored in the past, taking what I had heard and what I'd been through and sort of listening to what Nick and his partner Kyle were going through and just sort of talk frankly about that. And I don't think everything that happened to me and that I went through applied to you. But I think there was sort of, we had a come to Jesus or whatever your current God of choice is, discussion one day where I said, I know you guys are thinking about the next week or the next month, but let's talk about what this looks like 6 months or 12 months down the line. And, many times I think folks start out and they say, we're going to do this, and then we get to a point, we'll sort of do a check and we'll see where we are and decide what to do next. And I said to Nick, that's what I did. And it left me sort of totally blind beyond that checkpoint. And so we had a discussion about what happens when your business grows and what it takes to go somewhere and sell things and then the lag in time between selling and getting any money and which one of you is going to use your phrase, go all in, because one of you had to do it. Otherwise, you were going to be stuck in this point of, well, we're successful, but we're not that successful. And we're successful, but we're not successful enough to do that. And then you get sort of some technology stagnation, so to speak, where you need to go back and reinvest in your architecture. So we had a pretty interesting meeting. When I left that day, I remember you guys, I think there was still blood in your body, but there was none in your face. I'm absolutely certain there was none up here.
Yeah. So that day, we had just participated in the business plan competition, and we took third, which we were a little bit bitter about, but that's all right. But immediately during that day, we had several people come up to us and say they wanted to invest. And so for us, it was like we were, it could not have been a better day for us. Like we had participated, also good feedback, we had like people that were interested in giving us money, and that's when sort of Joel like brought us back to earth and said like, think real hard about this choice and make sure it's the right one, and make sure in a year you'll think, yep, that's the right choice.
I think I said don't take any money.
Yeah.
When you said, when you used the phrase goal, and maybe you talked about this earlier, but are you talking about hashtag one of yours, focus or time or financial resources or all of the above?
Yeah, so we were both my partner and I were full-time at the University of Montana. He in a sort of a marketing director role and myself as in a sort of web management role. And I think it was pretty clear that both of us trying to work full-time jobs and start this business wasn't really going to work out. Yeah, my business partner is now no longer with the University of Montana.
So let's pause on that, and let's just hear from Matt and Steph about how their relationship sort of started and has evolved.
Yeah, sure. So my approach to entrepreneurship kind of started with my education. I was a business student at the University of Montana, and through that got more and more involved in the entrepreneurship angle of it, and ultimately did kind of the same route that Nick did, competed in the business plan competition. Ultimately that business that we presented then is not what I'm currently doing. But what that kind of pushed me into was at that level, when you're, you know, kind of a college student, one of the things that's really pushed on you very hard and emphasized a lot is networking, kind of going out and meeting all the people that are in the community and taking advantage of things like Launchpad and business plan competition and all these kind of services that you can pick up on. And so I kind of started with Paul. I was one of the first interns at the Launchpad, and I started through there, and then the business plan competition, I started meeting more and more people. Ultimately, Mike Braun, which is funny because I'd never taken a class from Mike, but Mike Braun is a professor of management at the university. And ultimately, that's how I met Steph. So I kind of see this as a nice evolution from education to networking to this next level, which is, as we know, a real kind of mentor-mentee relationship is a lot more than networking. You're actually meeting not just anyone who will meet you, but the right person who can help you with the right things at the right time.
Yeah, I nailed it. What's funny about us being introduced through Mike Braun is that is who I would say has been my mentor. Since I graduated from college, he helped me launch my first business. He helped me negotiating selling it when I went and sold it. He advised me when I hated my company and when I loved it. And so I've always taken Mike really seriously. And so when Mike asks me to meet with someone, I always know that it's someone that it's important to him that I meet with the person, and that there must be some benefit, because he wouldn't have me meet with someone that he didn't think I could contribute to, which is how Matt and I met. And then it was never, and I think this is an important piece of mentorship, is we didn't go into it like, hey, do you want to mentor me? Sure, that sounds like fun. Like,
I didn't Google mentors.
Let's go on a blind coffee date and see if this works. You know, it's like we got set up to go out to coffee and talk about his business model, which was really similar to a business model I'm in, and see how I might be able to help him, talk him through some of the hurdles he's going to have ahead of him. And then we just kept meeting. Naturally, a problem would come up and he would call. I'd take the call, and then it naturally evolved to a point where it was important for me to take his call. Like, I might have been busy doing something else, but I knew if the phone rang and it was Matt, that it was probably important, because he wasn't calling me with, you know, stupid crap, I guess you could say. It was important stuff that he needed to talk through, and so just like it was important to him, it then also becomes really important to the mentor, which I'm sure they could agree with, is it's a valuable relationship both ways.
Yeah.
So that's the two dimensions I want to sort of get into next. Mm-hmm. So really from a mentee perspective, what are you sort of hoping to get out of the relationship? And John, you can probably talk about this from both mm-hmm. perspectives. And mm-hmm. then let's talk about what do the mentors get out of largely what seems like it's just a giving to somebody else. What do you get out of it? Maybe if we can, maybe John, I mean, obviously when you first started getting kind of advice, and
yeah.
what were you, or how have you absorbed that now in terms of what do you get out of those relationships?
So it's really interesting. I know now from both ends of what's needed or what do you want. So from a mentee, I kind of knew what I wanted, and now I kind of outgrew my mentors. I did. We outgrew and we stole the company. They knew that, and wasn't anything bad about it. In fact, the last 2 years, they were my board of directors, but they were no longer the mentors that were in the beginning, what I needed from them in the beginning. It's kind of like employees who actually make it through your company. They're the ones who started with you, and they actually change, and they get better, and they do this, and they adjust, and okay, there's now 35 employees, not four of us. Okay, we can no longer bring a six-pack of beer and stick it in my desk. So I got, okay, next. You know, that it was that's a good mentor. They'll know what you need. Here's what I could say is what I needed was honesty, sage advice from somebody that had done it, and what they need, and I know what they needed because one of my mentors is writing the foreword for our book, and he said, what should I write? And I said, why did you meet with me? I didn't pay you, I didn't give you any money, I didn't give you any advice. I mean, you know, why did you meet with me? And he said, you were one of the first people who actually listened. Mm-hmm. He goes, I had those coffee dates. Mm-hmm. That's funny you said that. Mm-hmm. I had those coffee dates one time, and I realized within about 10 minutes, they already had their own answers. And anything I was going to tell them just went in one ear and out the other. It's almost like talking to your teenage daughter. I'm going to use that. Mm-hmm. I finally said to her one day, I don't care if you like my advice or not, just nod your head, thank me, move on, do what you want to do. I said, you can do that. With one of my mentors, out of the three, who became, we call the three wise men, Leon's told me 9 words pretty much every time I met him. And I either heeded those 9 words and I thanked him 6 months later, or I apologized 6 months later because he was right. You know, those are the kind of people you want to put in your life. And so, it was interesting when I said that, from a mentor perspective, it was almost like, it really is, I'll say this, I think my father's happiest moments were when I said, Dad, yeah, you're right. You're right? You do. You think about that. My dad felt good. He gave me some advice. His son listened. That was a good day for him. And that's what Russ, Leon, and Ken were for me, is I wouldn't contradict them, right? And even when I wanted to contradict them, because they would say, you need to do this, and I don't know if you guys saw the rolling thing. Russ had put your big boy pants on. You're the CEO. And he actually said that to me in a meeting, and I was just like, wow, he just called me a wussy, man. Holy mackerel, you know. But he was right, because in the end, I was the CEO, and that was that. So, the honesty and all of that. But from both perspectives, I now find myself. I just want y'all to know, I don't waste my time with people when they're asking me something, and we talk. And they start regurgitating back to me that they know already. I don't need to tell them. I end the conversation. I got better things to do in my life. And that's kind of where a good mentor is going to be there. So you cannot go in there. You better go in there with hat in hand, and you better be humble. Or don't do it. You're wasting everybody's time.
Nick, what about you? What are you having to get out of?
I think, you know, like a lot of creative work, like entrepreneurship, they're like the highest highs and the lowest lows. And I think that one of the things is sort of like balance. You know, when we were like in the clouds because people wanted to invest, Joel said, you know, like, come back down and find the world again. Or when, you know, when you're struggling and you're not sure what's happening, like helping to sort of celebrate the wins that you've got and remember that, you know, the world's not ending. And then, I mean, just the experience, like the things, like, and it's even in passing, like, hey, did you, you know, you should reread this document just to make sure that it's sort of covering the things you expect it to or that you think about.
Joel, you referenced the fact you sought out a whole bunch of mentoring and advice from people when you were, and took some of that in terms of advice you gave Nick. What, out of that experience, did you, maybe some things that were really helpful and some characteristics that were helpful, as well as some things maybe you saw that weren't.
Yeah, I think I'd echo John that if you're going to sit down and talk with somebody and they're going to tell you they already know it, like I read that book, I know what to do, then I'm like you. I'm okay, yeah, I got another right. thing, yeah. But on the other perspective, when I was being mentored, I sat in with some folks who started telling me stuff, and I'm thinking, I think I heard that on a television show. Wasn't there a television show about Silicon Valley or something? And these guys are telling them, yeah, just give it away for free. And then, like, that's just that's a fad thing. I mean, and so I think a lot of times when I was being mentored, I had to really sort through what I was hearing. And it took a lot of patience, because sometimes I'd be sitting there listening to this stuff and they're just regurgitating something they heard on CNN. But if I just was patient enough, finally I might get something I could use. So then when I became a mentor, I found that one of the best things I could do is not talk. Nick and yeah. Kyle, what do you guys want to do? How do you feel about that? Where does that take you? What does that impact your technology? What does that impact your pricing model? And then maybe at the end I'd talk. And I felt like that was maybe a little better way to go about it. But I can say one other thing. Being a mentor, when someone like Nick or someone else, because I'm working with a lot of companies now, they ask me something, in my head I'm thinking, holy, I don't even know. And what comes out of my mouth is, I don't know, but I know somebody who knows that.
There you go. Right.
Because sometimes us, if you're mentoring someone, you feel like, I've got to know everything, right? Or they're going to lose confidence in me. And then what you find out is when you're honest back to them, I don't know, but I know so-and-so, and I'll find out from that person. And then you get the honesty, in my opinion, both ways.
I would say that in my experience, I don't do a lot of sifting through. So I'm sorry you had that experience.
Yeah, I did.
I don't do a whole lot of sifting. And I think what I've found, Steph, and correct me if you disagree, but the what I'm going to do, we're always kind of in line. And I think anyone with kind of a business mind, generally speaking, knows what they have to do. They have to break even, or they have to develop a strategic marketing plan, or they need to hire well. You know generally what you have to do, and through the process of talking out those what's, you realize, often I think we do that, yeah, that's pretty much what you need to do. That's not the reason you have a mentor. I think the value add from a mentor is, why do you need to do that? And that's where I think things shift a lot, because you think you need to do things for different reasons than you actually do. And then how to do it. You're talking to someone who's done it before, and hopefully you can jump that first iteration we all make, where you do something and you gut it out and you struggle through it and you kind of figure it out. And when it comes out, it's really not what you hoped, and maybe next time you'll get it better. How to do those things is huge. And then the last part is when. It's like, okay, so work with someone, you know generally what your business is going to do, what it's going to look like. When you pull the trigger on those things, and how do you prioritize them? That's where you really get the value add from someone who's experienced it before. And so I think trust your gut when you're the mentee, and just say in as plain terms as you can what you're trying to accomplish, and then lean on your mentor for when, why, and how.
I think too, I think you're totally right. The advice they gave me had nothing to do with the educational technology market. Nothing. And I'm just going to go through in 10 years the things that they taught me. Had a very loved employee kill himself. How do you deal with that? I'm on the phone. Police are calling me. They went in the house because he hadn't come to work for 2 days. He had no family. We dealt with that. And I remember, you know, and I said, you know, what kind of company are you? We literally were all the employees, and and I didn't know what to do. And they said, you got to get everybody together. And what's so interesting, what you just said, they said, John, you'll know what to do. Use your heart. You have such a good heart. Tell me exactly what. But get all your employees together. You'll know what to say. And I said, okay. And he said, I want you to call Jeff Smith, my executive coach that had hired. He said, I hear he's counseled with people. Why don't you talk to Jeff? See if he can just come in and just sit in a room, and if people need to come talk to him. You know, these are all things that I had no idea. Okay. And I use that story because a friend of mine calls me a year and a half later. He said, we just had an employee die. And I heard that you had to deal with that. What'd you do? And here you are sitting here going, yeah, okay. Here's all the things we did right and did we did wrong. But you're right. They never told me what to do. In fact, my biggest fight with our investor, who became a very close friend of mine, was he would walk in and tell me what to do. because that, you know, they're putting a lot of money. They kind of have that tendency. I don't know if you ever, you know, those of you digging on an investment, they kind of. And I sat down with him and I just said to him, and I, well, before that, let me be very clear. I called what we call the three wise men. I said, I can't go this way. And they said, then step up and deal with it, John. I said, what do you mean? Sit down and talk to him and tell him, you know, this is how you work. This is how you think. And I remember having that meeting Thanksgiving, 2013, my office, scotch on the table, Matt and I, Matt Spetzler, Matt, he's another Matt, Matt Spetzler and I sitting there, and I said, Matt, you got to quit telling me what to do. I said, ask me what I'm going to do, and then all the advice you give me, trust me, I'll listen, but just ask me what I'm going to do. I grew up with a family of seven. I'm the youngest of five boys. You start telling me what to do, my fists are coming up and we're going, right? Whether you're right or wrong, that's what I'm going to do. And so I totally agree with you, Matt. It was, they never told me, all right, here's how you sell into the educational, here's how you sell a SaaS product. It was, you know, what are you thinking? And then have you thought about this?
And I think like a polished mentor, even if they disagree with what you're about to do, they'll qualify that with one of those other things, which is, okay, maybe a good idea, but it's the wrong time, and here's why. You see what I'm saying
right,
there?
Right.
Yeah.
Yep. Steph, what do you mentor?
Yeah, so I like what Matt said, because it's how I know of mentoring and coaching, and it's something I always say to people that I'm working with is that I'm not meeting with people I don't believe can achieve what they want to achieve. I wouldn't meet with those people. So my job is not to tell Matt what to do. What we do when we meet is I facilitate him processing his own thoughts and solutions and help him create action plans around that processing. So I feel like my role in our relationship and others is that he has the answers. How he's gonna get to the goal might be different for me, but I'm okay with that. I just need to help him facilitate laying out that map so that he has direction to follow.
And it feels a little bit like therapy, and it's just therapy. It's cathartic, it really is.
But, not therapy.
But just having someone to kind of sit there and listen and process those things out with you is often all you really need.
Yeah. But on the why I mentor, I felt like I was really lucky to be developed really young. I was surrounded by, I felt like, the best people in business from pretty much day one of wanting to be in business. So I had every great advisor, every great lawyer, every great accountant along the way. And I almost had some guilt associated with that at one point where I was like able to do so much so quickly. And it's always just been as like to reconcile that, although that's probably not the right way to say it, is it's always just been really important to me to then give that back, to make sure that that person out there that wants to dump their life savings into their company, a lab or whatever it is, has the best chance to succeed. Because I think that a lot of people, you know, being an entrepreneur is really hard. You guys are mostly entrepreneurs, right? Like, it sucks on a lot of days, and then it's really great on other days. And so having someone to come along you and cheer you up when you need it, to help you stay focused when you need it, is really important. And so to be able to give that back to like the type of person I like to mentor is a first-time entrepreneur. And so to be able to give that back to someone knowing that they're like so excited right now and they're gonna hate life in 2 months and help them through that is just really rewarding, and it feels like you're giving back not just to yourself feeling good, but to your community.
Can I say one of the most important things for me was from a time perspective, when we were growing, they came in on our strategic hires, and they interviewed, they were in the interviews, the final interviews, so we did a lot of pre, all that, but they would come in on the final interviews and interview with me, and it was so big because I would have hired so many of the wrong people, and we would get out and I'd be like, you know, keep in mind, I've pre-interviewed all them, and I was like, all right. And I would go, okay, what do you guys think? I'm like, yeah, there's no way you're hiring that guy. I'm like, why? And they'll be like, this, 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 and this, John. And I would go, oh yeah, I didn't see that. You know, you get caught up in the emotion. And that Tom and Marcy hires at the end that really propelled us. Leon, the 9-word guy, we went through, can't tell you how many interviews. After Tom's interview, got up, looked at me, and just said, He's got 2 hours to get back home in North Carolina. I suggest you have that offer locked down before he gets there. And walked out the door. And I went, I mean, there was just no question, you know. But that's what a mentor did for me, was they sat in those rooms with so many different people, and they knew what fit me, and they knew what fit our company. And man, it was just, that was the most, probably, well, it's one of 20, but that was just so big because it saved me some bad hires. It really did. Yeah, ones I would have made.
So let me ask maybe a couple of my sort of tactical type questions, and then we'll open it up. In terms of sort of like, how often do you meet? Do you have formal structure to that, or is it kind of on call? You've talked about the fact you've had multiple kind of mentors, and here we're just showcasing sort of individual relationships, but kind of Nick, Matt, and any of the other people you think of as kind of mentors, just some practicalities of that relationship.
Nick? I guess I would say we don't have like a formal schedule at all. I meet with Steph every 2 weeks though.
We're not here together though. Yeah.
That's a totally different relationship.
That's different.
I'm not cheating on you,
you're
Joel.
You're cheating on me? Yeah.
I'm sorry.
And you brought that up in a public forum. What the hell?
The Zoom is a very small group.
It was coming out.
But actually, yeah. So,
and actually Joel and I, we work in the same buildings, like GeoFly and his company both live in the same building, so I've sort of popped over before, and that's been really, really nice, just proximity.
I'd say it's on call.
Yeah, like when I'm panicking or losing my mind, I call Joel and kill me.
Or we'll run into each other and say, for just example, randomly, a brewery.
Yes, randomly.
And suddenly our 10-minute how you doing thing becomes a 40-minute discussion.
Yeah.
So, yeah, exactly. Yeah. But really, to your point, I think a mentor is a good idea, but lots of them is a better idea. From whether I came to see you or I saw Mike Braun or whoever it was, I think that made sense. And you alluded to three wise men. I think that's...
I had three. We met once a month. I worked around their schedules. Cost me a beer and a lunch normally is what it was. And then they became the board of directors. That was the shift. They became, they were three of the five board of directors.
Okay.
And so what were you looking for in terms of what was different about the three of them?
Was
anything,
different.
Was it just sort of...
So they had all, I don't know about you guys, but so all three of them had built and sold companies, and they were probably the three most respected in the technology, the business community, and I did have no freaking clue why they would spend time with me sitting me down. And Ken Ferris he's the first one I met with, and then quickly realized we need to get others to help, and he actually asked another guy, he just sold... Bonds Hart just sold Meridian for $500 million, and he had asked Bonds to help. Would you want to sit on this council? Because Bonds was...
What did he see that said, kind of, you need help?
So we had grown...
What else was he looking to bring to the
conversation? Yeah, so we had grown at 800%, and then we grew 100%, and then we grew 100%. Mm-hmm. And so in that process, he's just like, you know, this is really... You've got something I think we need to bring. Like, I would just say, Joel... They would have said the same thing. One mentor is great, but you know, two or three of us working together, right? It's going to be a lot better. And
did you meet with the three together on a regular
basis? At all times. At all times, but they were also on call, so I could call them. But like you said, Matt, you just didn't pull that card for, hey, I'm looking at hiring a support rep today. I want to talk. You know, that was something major had happened, and I just want to get your advice. I'll give you one just really quick. We were hiring a strategic position, and a guy had applied, and they asked me to send me their resumes, and I did. And one of them came back to me and said, get that guy off your thing now. 10 years ago, he stole technology from another company that we know of. And he goes, how would I know that? You know, right? Yeah. How would I know any of that? How would I have ever found that out? But because I had mentors that were really involved in the community, just things like that just saved you so much. So, but we met monthly, and then I met quarterly, but I could call them anytime. But that was a...
What's your setup?
I feel Matt and I have two different relationships, right? So we have a mentor relationship, and then we also have a coaching relationship. So we meet every other week, and the coaching relationship is more about, and that's what I have with Nick.
I feel
you're
so
still
much
the
today.
Mentor.
So Steph, do you want to explain the difference?
Sure, yeah. So I also coach, and that's where I really spend a lot of my time with new entrepreneurs. And our coaching relationship is more around Matt determining the main objectives to make his business successful, us really putting them out there as big goals, and creating very clear strategies and actions around how to achieve them. So that meeting every other week is very structured, very organized. There has very clear objectives and has like this is how it goes every time we meet. And where's the progress and what's next? And I would say I do very little advice giving and speaking in our coaching relationship. And then in mentoring relationship, it's different. It's probably not in that time that we're meeting. And that's more in spaces of, I've got a problem I need to talk through. And it's
usually random. I'm close to tears.
No. Yeah, and I think that's where a mentor is really valuable of being on call is when you're new and you have a lot of money on the line, like small problems feel really big. It's sometimes really hard to see the light at the end of the tunnel or to see the way out or the way to success. And that's what I was saying earlier, like when Matt's calling, I pick up because you don't want him to like go rogue, but usually it's just like needing to talk through something to process your own thought and get out of the clouds to see what the solution is and then go after that solution.
Yeah.
And that's a different thing from coaching.
Yeah. And I would add to that. From the coaching perspective, I like the structure. I feel like it is, I mean, Steph is the secret sauce, but the structure that she's built around it is what kind of drives the results. And so we meet, is it bi-weekly? Is that every 2 weeks?
Yeah.
I can never, if that's twice a week or every 2 weeks. But then I have kind of a check-in on a week that we're in the interim weeks where we're not meeting. I have like, I want to get 50% of these things done. And so we do kind of have checkpoints, and that just like you always say, Steph, like being an entrepreneur, you could stay in your pajamas all day long and like no one will care. And I think through the structure that we have around coaching, I know at least one person cares, and they, you know, they care a great deal. And obviously I don't want to let you down, but I don't want to let myself down if I've said I'm going to do something. So I think structure works good. I also think it's invaluable to have someone that you can get to on the other end of the line when it is, you know, code red, as I like to say. So both are really different and really integral in the process. But I like to think that, or I try to just have mentors from everyone that I meet, because I think that you can learn something from, you know, all kinds of different people. It doesn't need to specifically be a coach. It just happens that with Steph, it's so great for me because at least one of your businesses is so similar to mine, so similar. So she's great both from a coaching perspective and a mentoring perspective, which is just kind of more directed, pointed questions like, hey, I know you've done this, how?
So is tell me how, so I don't have to duplicate it.
Exactly.
Is the coaching relationship more about accountability?
I wouldn't say so. I mean, the accountability is to the degree in which the coachee pushes themselves outside of their comfort zone.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not going to be hard on someone that doesn't accomplish a goal. I'm going to facilitate them thinking through why they didn't accomplish it and whether or not it was important to them.
Maybe that's the right way to talk, because what I'm thinking about is someone who is an entrepreneur as well. When I started, it took me a while because I'd been in a professional services environment for 14 years as a partner there. I was used to having, even though I was a partner, there were other more senior partners, was used to always having someone who I would be checking with, okay, should I do this or should I do this, or hey, you need to do that, and telling me what to do. There was always someone to check in with, and as an entrepreneur, you suddenly have that aha moment. I was like, oh, there is nobody to ask that to.
That's so why I always use like the Netflix example. Yeah. Like if you want to binge watch Netflix now that you're an entrepreneur, you can, and no one gives a shit, but your business might not succeed.
Right.
So if you want some built-in coaching and accountability, I could do that.
Right, yeah.
But Netflix is good too.
And it's not that I need you to potentially bash me, it's just the fact that I'm going to have to meet you and fess up.
And you told me what you want to accomplish. Right. Verbalizing what you want to accomplish is probably the key there.
Well, it's. I think it's the, why does it matter?
Right.
What I mean by that is we should say that about our employees, you know, they're on Facebook or they're whatever, they're binge watching whatever. And we would, in the end, this is what my mentors would say, who cares? And I said, are they getting their job done? Are they doing what they need to do? Mm-hmm. You know, are they interacting well or whatever it is? I'm not gonna use the binge watching, but it's really the, what is the outcome, like you said? If the outcome of you binge watching is your business is gonna be hurt, yeah, you might wanna see if Steph can hang out with you for once every couple of weeks. But seriously, I mean, those are good steps to take, but where a great mentor is where the coaches really get you to focus in on is it has nothing to do with binge. Like you said, if you want to, that's great, but know what the consequences are and to be able to do that with your employees and do that with yourself and do that as you grow. It's just it's a big step. Me, we had cable television in the basement when we first were working, and I thought they would watch TV all day long and not work, right? And then you get to stop and say, well, what if they did watch TV and actually got the work done? What does it matter? I mean, you know, in the end, you want the work done. That's what you want. How do you get there? What if I did it from, like Matt programmed, till 4 a.m? That's when he coded. I mean, you could probably jump in and say, yep, that's what happens sometimes. Yep. I had no understanding of that, by the way. Mm. I didn't understand people did that.
Right. All right, so let's open it up. Who has some questions for these folks? Sounds right at the back there.
For those of you that are doing the mentoring and the coaching, have you been in a situation where you were dealing with someone that you realized shouldn't be going into business? They were going to take their credit cards or their parents' savings or their savings and open up a copy release to shop, and they just had it decorated and had a great recipe for stone. You want to hear about how to operate a business? How do you handle it? Go ahead and do that case.
I don't know.
Well, for me, I would just tell you, you just literally have these conversations where they want everyone else to go all in except for themselves. That's what you just kind of hear. It's kind of what you just kind of explained. I would say to you, I don't think I've ever heard anybody that, in a sense, I would say had a bad idea and they shouldn't do it, because I wouldn't know. But if you don't get the sense that they're willing to, if they're not the ones willing to risk it, so many have asked me to risk it for them as they were asking for advice, they want me to risk it for them. You know, that's when you know you're just wasting a lot of people's time and money, because I'm not going to be passionate about your idea. Nobody will except for you. And if like Nick and I'm sure Matt and Steph and you at one point, we all had to go on and told we all had to go all in. So I think a coffee barista is an awesome idea if that's what you want to do and you want to make it the greatest coffee barista ever, you know. But
I think that what we're really talking about, though, is like a small percentage of the population. I mean, like, most businesses probably fail not because of a bad business model, but because someone doesn't have the drive to get through bringing it to market. And I think that if you're out seeking a coach and, you know, putting aside these people who are that we talked about who just really don't want advice.
Right.
If that person's out there and they're active, I mean, maybe there's some people that are really motivated and just have a really wrong direction. But I haven't met one yet.
Yeah. But I think just based on what I do in the Launchpad,
yeah,
kind of week in week out. I mean, I probably talk to 150 entrepreneurs a year who have ideas at various stages. And the thing I love about our program and the philosophy that came from the University of Miami is, it's to help the students and the faculty and staff and me with explore entrepreneurship as a viable career path. So it's a journey of exploration. It's not my job. I'm nowhere near smart enough to tell them whether their idea is any good. And it won't be me or anyone else that tells them, be the marketplace. So we're helping them take the steps to figure out the things they need to do to figure out if they can be successful with it. If they've got the determination, most of them will figure out a way. It may end up looking a heck of a lot different to what they started with, but they'll be successful.
So may not,
I think
even
it's
be less,
I don't think
business.
It's the mentor or the coach's job to say, this is a dumb idea, you shouldn't do it. It's like, here are some
horrible
questions, you need to go get some answers.
Yeah,
I'd like to follow on that, because I've had two that I can think of that I know, I went, as I'm driving home, I'm thinking, they're out of their mind. But it's, I think I'm with you, it's not my job to say that, but I will say this, when I'm having those thoughts in my head, you're out of your mind, I'm asking questions to guide them to understand why I came to the idea that they were out of their mind. I want to lead them to that painting that I'm looking at, and I want to sort of put some rails on it so they understand the risk, the downsides, where you'd be at the end if this didn't work, or what you'll be going up against. So it's kind of like I'm hoping they'll see it. But back to my slimy lawyer job, there's many times I have people call me and say, I'm going to do X. And I'll say, you can't really do that, and here's why. And they say, well, just write up some language and I'll do it. And I have to come back and sort of say, here's my email to you telling you that I'm not going to do that because, and after that, if they go do it, there's nothing I can do. So I don't know if that answers your question, but I try to lead them to the water trough that they shouldn't be drinking out of, and then they can see why and not do that. But some people, you can't stop them. You can't head them off.
Yeah, clean.
Can I ask a follow-up question around education versus guidance? So for those that are mentoring, how much time do you feel is a moment of education? This is a decision around financial analysis. This is a decision around market viability, whatever. And then how far do you take that responsibility of being the educator? And does that still shape and come out as guidance? Or do you truly tell individuals that they need to learn more about XYZ topics so they can be more informed in their decision making?
Well, I think the kind of question you just asked, for me, it's really tough in the sense of, for me, what worked out in my world was the question you just asked from the financials and, you know, this and that, that's a, to me, a board of directors. I would want to put in not a mentor group, but an actual board of directors. That's their job. They're going to really help me get to that, the budget, the finances, the expansion, the scalability, all those. From a mentor's aspect, I really do. I think it's a real, I don't want to say one-off type of a thing, but it really is in a sense of, here's what's happening in my moment, and I know you've experienced that. This is what I'm thinking about. Is that right? You know, and they're going to ask the next four questions so I can answer those. And I think it's just two totally different. That's my opinion. It's just two totally different things of utilizing utilizing someone's time and expertise. And two completely different, I think there's just two different forms for that. I don't think it's a mentor's, once again, I think you start crossing a line as a mentor in there, really getting, I would say, down the weeds. I don't think a mentor would get down in the weeds on that.
Yeah.
I don't know, you guys can tell.
It's a funny kind of thing with education, because you can kind of go out and learn whatever you want to learn. You can YouTube it, someone will teach you how to do it, but that presupposes that you know what you don't know. Like, you know, where does that fit in?
Yeah. You know that you don't know.
Yeah,
that.
Exactly.
So I'm gonna go. Yeah, exactly. The problem is you don't know what you don't know, right?
No knowns and known unknowns.
No.
So I have a question. I really appreciated the day yesterday. Thank you. John did a great job, as well as Linda and the rest of the panel. But I kept hearing all in. I heard all in today, and I sort of get all in. I understand really long days, really long work weeks, and developing your product and your brand and what it takes to own, operate, manage a business with multiple employees. Okay. I got that one figured out. I also understand the concept of more of an open office and setting goals and objectives and managing that way so it's not just 8 to 5. That's not necessarily the example for the highest productivity. What I'm having a little trouble with is how, as individual people who have spent the time and the resources to go all in to create a business, how do you manage your time between the employees that need your mentoring and coaching, right, and the outside element that is great for your personal benefit and growth, right? But when you're mentoring Matt, you're not mentoring the people in your office, right? You have a family too. I caught that yesterday.
Yep.
Right, so let's start putting the time balls in the air. Here's the family.
Yep.
Here's the business and the employees.
Yep.
Oh, here's Matt.
So you're under the assumption, which is a great one, because all of us do that, that you're the one that's going to do all of those things. Where my big one is, I found Stephanie. Truly, I'm going to say this. I found Stephanie. I brought Stephanie into my life, which is Jeff Smith, and Jeff coached me. So here was my coaching. I got mine.
Right.
I had the CEO roundtables once a day. I went all through all that. But the other thing I didn't talk about yesterday, we really invested into our employees' growth. Okay. So Jeff worked with the executive team and then the management team. Did that. We started paying him to do that. We built in where our leadership was now starting to mentor, not me. They used to call it the John Bomb. I'd come by and sit down at their desk and stick my feet up and go, all right, how y'all changing people's lives today? And they're like, you know, I'm working, but the CEOs, so that started to go by the wayside, where we started utilizing, as you grow, there's a point where you are only scalable as a human, so far as that's what you're kind of asking. For us, it was we brought in people, brought in experts to free us up to not be just bogged down with everything. So,
I would say, so right now, I work for the University of Montana from 8 to 5. I have 3 employees. I'm starting a business, and I have a family. And the best way I have figured to combat that is just to be like real upfront and communicate with everybody. Like the employees that I have, like I used to put in like 60-hour weeks for the University of Montana, just for the university. Like I used to, do the work from 8 to 5 and then go home and do more work. So when I stopped doing that, the folks that worked with me at the university were like, wow, like we can really feel this. Everything is slower than it was before. And just being honest with people and like honest with my wife about like if she wants me to work less hours or find different hours to work, trying to sort that out, as opposed to you can't do everything. So being clear with the people around you about what you're gonna do and try to manage those expectations. I mean, they're not fun conversations to have, but that's one of the things I think Steph's helped me with a little bit is just talk about it with people and try to, I mean, sometimes you have to be more formal with things that you used to not have to be so formal with. Like, we grocery shop on Saturdays at about 1 o'clock. That's when it fits in the schedule.
I could answer your question too, if you're okay with that. I think you give a really good point of when we're spending our time with mentors and all this stuff, are we mentoring our own employees? And I know for me, I can say I'm not spending enough time mentoring my own employees. And it's probably unfortunate, right? Because I'm super passionate. We all tend to spend our time on what we care about, right? And I really care about first-time entrepreneurs to the expense of probably mentoring my own employees. I came to that conclusion, though, and I made sure my managers were really good and had a lot of structure around what it meant to be a mentor to the people they were managing. So, in short, I don't mentor my employees well because I'm more passionate about mentoring entrepreneurs. And maybe they'd be better off with me there.
You'd make a great mentor, to be very honest. Yeah. I appreciate that.
But if you're trying to say to you, I feel like your strength is with entrepreneurs.
Right.
And so you to me, this is how I would view it. If you switch that, you could become more of a hurdle over here than a great, adding great value here. But if you're hiring the right people and empowering them and letting them, we don't need 25 cooks in the kitchen. You empower and trust and hold them accountable. I think that's a, I think what happens is we all feel guilty. I think that's what happens. Because we just feel, whether it's feeling guilty about my wife, about my daughter, about my managers, about my whatever, you just feel guilty because you only have so much time and I can only shop with you at 1 o'clock on Saturday, right? I mean, but that's our problem is we feel so bad and nobody says to us, it's okay if you don't spend time with me. It's all right. It's okay. I feel it's all right. We don't get that. We get the full guilt trip that falls on us. And I think we're all people. I think one thing we don't talk about entrepreneurs is I think and by and far entrepreneurs are very kind. We are. I think we're just kind people. Most really good entrepreneurs I've met are just kind people. We want to do well. We want our employees to do well. We want our communities to do well. And so we're really great at feeling guilty about stuff. And so
I hope that, and I don't know if this is true, this is just a philosophy I'll throw out, but I hope that it's kind of like a pay it forward situation.
Absolutely.
Where, yes, Steph is taking time away from her employees, but she's mentoring me, which is saving me a ton of time, so that maybe later on down the road, I'll have the time to
You'll do the same
people
thing.
The same way.
Absolutely. Yeah.
I don't know if that's true, but I hope it's true.
I think that's
Let's
definitely
go with
true.
That.
Yeah. Let's go with that. Yeah. I feel better.
Yeah. I think the other characteristic of entrepreneurs, I mean, certainly when you start a business, is you'd have to do everything.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So part of, I think, what this mentoring, this coaching process is to help you understand how and when to start bringing other people in to do things. And that's really a lot of your answers were, well, I get other people to do some of that.
Well, we're so used to kindergarten soccer. Have you ever watched kindergarten soccer? Everybody runs to the ball to kick the ball, right? That's starting a company. That's what we all do. There's a ball. Try to kick it. You're trying to tell these little kids, no, Joey's the one who kicks it when it's over there, you know, but we're so used to that, right?
When you're the custodian of the vision.
Yeah, you've got it all, right? We're not only kicking the ball, we're coaching. In fact, we're talking to the parents over here, too. And, you know, this is our problem, and it's trying to break away from that, right? And literally, what are those levels? And just from what Stephanie just described, I don't know how big your company is, Stephanie, I really don't know that. But just from what she described, I think there's nothing wrong with that. You know, and I always tell my wife, I told her, I said, I'm just through being apologetic. I just am. I feel like I've apologized for 10 years about everything. You know, I do. I feel like I've apologized for 10 years. And so I think it's that's the mentor. I think you're right. It is. It's our job to pay it forward.
Well, I also wonder, though, Steph, like when you, in those situations when you do have to step in and maybe talk to a manager, and do you feel like your time spent outside of your businesses with me makes you more effective when you do have to step in?
Sure. I mean, growing and developing in any way as a leader is going to play out in your own business. I step in when it counts, right, to my own company. I have the hard conversations and I need to have them. But then I also believe that my managers need the autonomy and ability that I trust them to be mentors to other people, which could, as you might imagine, be a little intimidating when my role outside of the store is mostly to be a mentor to people and coach. But they're fully capable and I step in when it counts. So yeah.
Thank you. So John said it just a minute ago that entrepreneurs are very kind, so you've all been very kind to share your time and expertise for this kind of last hour, so I really appreciate that. And what I would say is, I mean, all my experience in this Missoula community, I think you've observed this, John, is it's a very supportive and collaborative community. So if you came to this because you're looking for some mentoring or some coaching, there are a lot of people here to kind of help you do that, so to reach out. And I'm also going to promote the final two activities of the State of Missoula today, which is starting at 3:30 over at the Public House, which is a new kind of co-working and event space, which is right next to Lake Missoula Tea Company on East Broadway. There's going to be another workshop on really kind of how do you think about and go about funding your startup. Some great panelists, unfortunately, including me, so you're going to have to listen to me again if you want to do that. And then at 4:30, and you can come to one or both of these, at 4:30, the Hellgate Venture Network, which is an entrepreneurial networking group, which I co-founded about 8.5 years ago now. We are having a networking reception at the Public House as well, and there is free beer. If that happens to appeal to anyone, you're welcome to come to both of those events. Both of those events are free. You don't have to have pre-registered to come to those events. So, quick hand to thank our panelists.
Well, thank all of you for taking some time out of your day to spend with us this afternoon. I hope you have found the workshop so far, if you've been participating, worthwhile and engaging. I think it's really important that we continue to stress the role of entrepreneurship in our community. My name is James Grunke, and I'm the CEO of the Missoula Economic Partnership. And we are the local economic development agency for our community. And we do a variety of things, but we're predominantly focused on three areas. What are we doing to help existing businesses grow and expand? How are we attracting new companies into our area? And what are we doing to have a robust startup community? And one of the ways that we work in the startup community is we created our own angel investment network called the MEP Angel Network. And what we're trying to do through our network is bring equity capital funding to startups in our community. And we really work on both sides. We work to attract high net worth investors. And the way we do that is by having good deals. And then we try to attract good deals by having good investors. And that's what we do. And we really kind of put it together. So we don't actually get part of the deal. We're think of us as kind of eHarmony for money. We're just trying to put it together. Moneymatch.com. Or maybe it's Tinder, because we actually want something to happen, right? I've heard about it. Probably good. So, you know, our original topic today was going to be how do you pitch a deal, and it became a little complicated because we were going to actually have some companies actually do a pitch in front of real angels so you could see what it's like. The difficulty is when you're dealing with this, they have to be only in front of accredited investors, and we would have had to certify that everybody had been here. So really, we thought the conversation today really is going to focus around what kind of financing do you need and how do you get it? And I think most people believe there's kind of two ways that you get money. The first is you go to the bank. You go to the bank, you say, hello, this is what I want to do. Can I have a loan? They say no, and you leave and you say, huh, there's no capital here. Or you say, oh, I need investment in my company. And this would be a very typical way people do it. Huh, I need $100,000 so I can grow my company, and I'm willing to give up, I don't know, and it's normally a number that's just picked out of the air, 10% in exchange for $100,000. Well, actually, there has to be a little more value on what your $100,000 is. So the $100,000 at 10% of the company means you're saying your company's worth $1 million. And it probably really isn't. So again, you'd say, huh, I couldn't get a bank loan, I couldn't get equity capital, and there's no capital in Montana. And I think we heard yesterday, if you were at luncheon, if you're a good deal, capital will find you. There is more capital looking for a home than you could ever imagine. So I don't think it's a lack of access to capital. I think it's a lack of preparation for capital. And that's what this panel today is going to be about. We also spend a lot of time talking with businesses, at least through the Missoula Economic Partnership, and they're all focused on the capital side. And we say, you know, actually a pretty good source of capital is sales or revenue, customers. You know, that's not a bad way to raise money either. And so instead of trying to capitalize on what's my financing need, but we want to know, what's your customer strategy? How are you going to get them? What is your sales strategy? So, again, we're going to talk about that. The other thing that we try to preach to entrepreneurs is you need to tell your story at every opportunity you can. Practice, practice, practice what your elevator pitch is. Tell your story all the time. I also ask oftentimes, what type of companies are investors looking to invest in? Companies that make money. That's it. That's what they're looking for. Now, they may have some special interests. Maybe I want to be in technology, or I want to be in food, or whatever it is. Companies that make money. And so when we talk to an entrepreneur, for you entrepreneurs, I apologize, but they want to tell me on and on and on and on and on about their product. And yeah, I kind of want to know, but not really. We want to know because What are people really investing in? People. You. Do I believe that you can do it? Do you have the right team? How are you going to get your customers? We said, not just customer one, but customer number 50 and customer number 500. I thought that was really interesting when John spoke yesterday about their business model that they did. They had 90%+ of the market of Virginia captured, but nowhere else. So they hadn't thought through those steps. And then the other thing that is a trait of Montanans in particular is there is no group of people that are more willing to help than a Montanan, and no group of people more unwilling to ask for help than a Montanan. Ask for help. Know what you don't know. Everybody wants to help you, but they don't know that. So you can't be afraid to ask. They want to hear from you. And then finally, in order to get money, is you actually have to ask for it. You have to close the sale. That's often times what people also don't do. They don't just ask for the money. And when you're asking for money, you need to know what it is you're asking the money to be used for and why you need it. So today's panel is going to be about what type of funding do you need and how do you get it? And those two types, debt or equity, are probably two of 200 different ways that you could raise money or raise capital. And I think we have a great panel of people to kind of talk this through. So they're going to give you kind of some of their ideas, but really we want to have a conversation with you today. My job is only to keep the trains on time and keep us occupied until we can have beer at 4:30, right? So first and foremost, we have Paul Gladden. Paul is the director of the Blackstone Launchpad. I'm sure many of you know Paul already. He is vital to the startup community in our city and in our state. He was one of the founding members of Hellgate Venture Network. He was a former partner for Arthur Anderson. It wasn't Arthur Anderson? Recovering accountant. He also started his own company when he first moved to Missoula, and he's looked at lots of different ways for financing. And he's more on my side of the table where we're talking about with entrepreneurs, how do you prepare? Next, we have Molly Bradford. So Molly Bradford, also serial entrepreneur, but she's going to give us a perspective of what is it like as the startup to try to get the money, and actually sometimes to turn down money. Not all money is the right money for you. And remember, whoever's money you take, it comes with them. And that's not always what you want. Not to mean that's how I introduce Kai. So Kai is with Good Works Ventures. Good Work Ventures is a local investment fund, and they're going to talk to you about that. And then finally, we have John Horner from First Interstate Bank, who is also our sponsor today. Thank you, John. And we're all going to start, they're going to start with this same question. What do I need to do to get money from you? Or, Molly, what did I have to do to actually get money? So I don't know who wants to start, but that's the premise. What does it need to look like for us to receive money from you? And maybe, Paul, I'm going to have you start, just kind of frame it in your world, and we'll go through the panel. They're going to give you their thoughts. And again, this is a conversation, not a lecture. And I'm here, if there's not a question, just to think of one.
Thank you, James. So mostly people are not going to get money from me, but there is actually one way to get money from me, which is an illustration of also, or the explanation of it will get to other places to get money. So one of the things we do at the Launchpad, we have something called the 4th F Fund. And if you ever go to a class that talks about where do you get money from, the starting point is something called the 3 Fs, which is friends, family, and fools. And friends and family can often be very helpful for getting money to start. But the 4th F fund, we realized that in Montana, the 3 Fs may have about $50 to rub together, and that's probably not going to be enough to get your business started. So we have a small fund of money which we probably provide to students and some alumni to help them get started, and addresses this sort of proof of concept point, which I think in many ways gets to the thing I say most to people when they come into the launch pad and say, hey, I've got this idea, and they often say two things. So I need to write a business plan, and I need to get funding. And my response is usually, well, you sort of don't need to do either of those things yet. Because really the starting point is to figure out, do you actually have something that the world wants? So that's really where we focus a lot of our time and attention, is helping the entrepreneurs who have these amazing ideas say, go try generate some evidence that customers want this. Because investors, both kind of equity investors and kind of bankers, to James's point, want to see a return on their money, and they're only going to get that if you can develop a profit, which means you have to have customers. So the starting point is really to understand who is that customer base, and there are a lot of techniques, and I won't go into that. We can cover that in different panels and different workshops about the techniques for sort of customer discovery and product market fit. But those are things you need to sort of do early on. But the reason we created the Fourth F Fund is because we do recognize that sometimes to help you validate that you have a product or a service or an idea that customers are really interested in, is you need to create some sort of prototype or proof of concept or do some additional research. So we started the Fourth F Fund, and we've got some funding both through Montec, which is the university's incubator, and through the Missoula Federal Credit Union, which has enabled us to provide some small sums of money to entrepreneurs to go do a little bit of that proof of concept work. So I think it's important for you to, as you start out potentially on that journey of saying, okay, I've got this great idea, I've got this business I want to build, I need funding, is first to say, do you actually have some evidence that the marketplace wants it, and what can you do to really kind of get yourself to a point where those sources of funding, which may even be kind of friends and family. So an example that many of you may be familiar with, George Gaines, who came third in the Business Startup Challenge last year with Chilton Skis. He came and talked to us in the launch pad kind of a year ago and said, hey, I've got this idea, I want to start my own ski company, but I know nothing about business and I have no money, but my father said he might give me some money if I can sort of demonstrate I've got a decent business plan and a way to go about doing that. So we worked with him to put a financial model that showed this is what you would need to build a prototype. And with a prototype, you can potentially get people to test out your skis and to potentially pre-order so you could fund your first production run. And so we worked with him, and we gave him a little bit of money from the Fourth F Fund, and we matched it up with the money from his father that enabled him to build his prototype skis, to pitch in the Business Startup Challenge, where he won several thousand dollars, and more importantly, had people in the audience that evening coming up to him saying, I want to order a pair of these skis. So we're now working with him on actually starting to put a Kickstarter campaign, so we can talk a little bit perhaps later on about crowdfunding. But there is a journey that you can go through, but it all starts with, do you have some evidence that the marketplace kind of wants your product? So maybe I'll leave it at that and pass it on to Molly.
Some of you here know my story pretty well on the panel also, so if you feel like there's something that I've done to get money that I'm forgetting, please prompt me. But I own Gatherboard, which locally you might know as MissoulaEvents.net. It's a free online community events platform here in Missoula, and that was initially my business partner Colin Hickey's and mine. First product, along with Missoula Indoor Ads, which are the bathroom ads that you see, the potty ads that you see all over town. There's actually two bathroom ad companies. We own Missoula Events, Missoula Indoor Ads, which are the single black 8.5 by 11 frames in about 300 high traffic locations around Missoula. So the first way that we got money was from the bathroom ads and figuring out how to monetize MissoulaEvents.net about 10 years ago when online was something skeptical. I left a long-standing, very successful advertising career at the Missoula Independent as their lead ad rep, and a lot of people saying, good luck with that internet thing. So good luck with that internet thing. I started a software company. First, we had a different product that we were entrepreneurs for that was very local, and we realized that people wanted that product in their community. We got random calls from Hoboken, New Jersey, and Homer, Alaska, and Helena, Montana, saying, I want MissoulaEvents.net in my town. And by about the third or fourth call, I looked at Colin and I said, I think we have a product people want. So they kind of told us we wanted the product instead of us telling them. But then we did a little bit more research on that. Luckily, I had income coming in from Missoula Indoor Ads. So we were able to bootstrap a lot of the software development process for ourselves. Luckily, Colin's brother is a legitimate high-level IT guy, and my brother is a legitimate high-level intellectual property lawyer, so we were also able to get a tremendous amount of legitimate support for free. So that was our friends and family round, I think I'll call it. And there was no equity exchange. There was just love, brotherly love in that one. And actually, the first time either one of them, we requested that they send us an invoice so we could pay them. I think Colin and I like both cried that we could actually pay our brothers real money and not keep taking free things from them. So I got things for free. I made my own money from a secondary or an initial product that supplemented something I was turning into a far greater product. I also did an economic gardening round, I'm just remembering, with BRED, the Bitterroot Economic Development District, which I think is sort of phasing out and maybe some of their services are being assumed by MEP and other things like that. But we were much smaller than most of their economic gardening clients, but I asked for it. I said, look, this is not fair that you have to have $1 million in revenue to be considered. What happens to people like me that have barely have $100,000 in revenue and I need the same help and I'm trying to start a software company and I don't want to relinquish equity. So I was able to get, I had to fill out a ton of questionnaires that really helped me continue to define what is my market, what is my strategy, what am I spending this money on. But I was able to get an initial $7,500, which at the time is a lot of money, to do a competitive analysis of other calendaring software in the American market and find out who we were up against, what they were offering, what their competitor, what their customer base looked like, how they were marketing themselves, how they were pricing themselves, what their core features were, so that I could do competitive analysis for Gatherboard and where we wanted Gatherboard to go and how we would price it. So that was probably the next round in my kind of official first bit of money. Most recently, we've actually gotten we went back to our banker who we work with, First Security, I'm sorry, it's not First Interstate, but, and you, Ms. Fed, case in point, lots of really great banks in town who want to work with small businesses and big businesses. So we work with First Security, we meet with our banker regularly, because I've had those oh shit moments where I realized I was maybe going to overdraw my account, and also I want to have those like hell yeah moments where I'm ready to start growing. That's where we are now. We needed to bring on more staff to handle the growth that we are projecting and that we were also experiencing. I needed an IT person on staff, a salesperson, and a support person to continue to run my local products and expand my national software product. So I spent about 6 months with the help of SBDC at the Launchpad. Kai and Dawn actually quizzed me a lot on stuff I considered doing alone or some equity work with GoodWorks Ventures, a lot, James's team at MEP, I asked for it. I went to every single free resource I could find and I asked for help because I didn't have all the answers. And I figured out that really I probably needed somewhere between $40,000 and $80,000. And I didn't want to go through a valuation and I didn't want to give that up. And so I went back to my bank. Well, now we'd been in business for 9 years. The software company had been in business for 3 years. It's been profitable since the beginning. We have good growth. Our indoor ads continue to have good growth. Our online ads of the local calendars we own. So we just did two different $40,000 loans. One's revolving, a business revolving line of credit. We actually haven't used it at all. And the other one's term, but we had 9 months in interest only. So we did all these like really great things. And then the third thing that I hope happens, fingers crossed, I just did a lot of work with Nicole on James's team at MEP and Jenny to put together a bid for the Big Sky Economic Development Trust Fund, which will, if we get it, will help us create 4 jobs in 2017 and 4 jobs in 2018, each one with roughly a $7,000 salary and jobs creation match to help with equipment and lease space and computers and and then also in parallel with, in tandem with that, a training, workforce training grant that would come through that. I'm sorry if I'm not remembering all the names correctly. So I hope that that happens too, because that'll help me take my part-time employees and turn them into full-time employees and give me some matching funds in there. I will say the other thing we did one small equity thing. Our programmer has always been in a work-for-hire relationship with us. He has his own company. He's a good friend of my business partner and a solid programmer in town. And the day we were going to ask him if he would give us a cheaper programming rate in exchange for a small bit of equity in Gatherboard, he actually called us and said, I'll give you a cheaper rate for a small. And we were like, okay, done. So we negotiated 5% equity for him, and he would work for $20 an hour. I mean, that was like amazing. And we actually took it much further, and we ended up giving him 10% of the company. So he doesn't own any of MissoulaEvents.net or Missoula Indoor Ads, but we have a 10% profit sharing agreement in Gatherboard, and if we ever split that off into its own LLC, then he will own 10% of it. So I guess we've done a combination of a lot of things. But every time it was more customers, proof of concept, the marketplace wants it.
Hello. Hey.
Do you have a question first?
You were describing your search for capital, and you said you went for every resource you could find. Where is that listed?
Oh, well, MEP has a list on their website.
Part of it's on the back of the name tags.
The back of the name tags does also, yeah. So, but the Missoula Economic Partnership, the Montana-Idaho CDC, the Montana-Idaho Community Development Corp, which is actually who we originally went to get the indoor ads going with free business plan coaching, and SBDC, who we've been beneficiary of a ton of free help to do pro forma work and pricing and marketing and other things, and that's in the Launchpad office essentially, right? I mean, it's kind of that whole university. And then I show up. I go to 1 Million Cups, I network, I go to Downtown Association things, I'm here, I go to Hellgate Venture Network, and I'm also our head salesperson, so I ask for money all the time.
And I should just say, so there's a myth in our country that an entrepreneur is supposed to do it all, and that's crazy, right? Who can do it all? You're supposed to know every answer? You don't. All you need to know is we know the resources, or we know where to go. And that's, I think, we want to position the economic development. Now, MEP may not be the one who solves it, but we should know who to solve the problem for you. So, but that's a great start question. And now we'll go back to Kai. How do we get money out of you?
That's a really good question. It depends. That's how I like to answer every question. The biggest thing, and you know, Paul touched on it some, and we really refer a lot of people over to Paul if they haven't done the legwork themselves, is hammering out the business plan. It's not a business plan that's a nice thick stack of papers that have a lot of words on them. It's, can you show me on paper and in spreadsheets in some viable way that you can see a way out of this from, you know, your over burn rate where you're in the hole to, hey, we're starting to become a profitable company and we're sustainable at some level. We look at companies that some of these are, you know, trying to raise in Silicon Valley, so they've got a very different trajectory than more of a localized company who is creating goods or services to service the market around here. And so the funding resources that each company is going to use is very different. We structure everything between, usually early on the stage, we play with what's called a convertible note. And so that takes this equity conversation out of it. At that stage, your company, nobody really knows what your company's worth, because it's not. There's a lot of theory. There's a lot of, well, it's potentially this. But you've proven to us, and we've had conversations, and we know that you need $50,000 or $100,000. And that is where we start, and we say, okay, so we set some limits on what, you know, based on a time frame, or on a qualified financing round, that's when we convert from debt to equity. And there's some different negotiated points in there. One of those is the discount, and the other one is really where's that threshold? Is it going to have a maximum valuation of $500,000 or $2.5 million? And it really depends on the amount of traction in sales. The more time with us that you can get down that road and prove more either sales in the pipeline or show really that traction that you have beyond R&D. Like we don't fund R&D processes. It's not what we do. That's a big black hole. And we just, that requires funds that is not out there for us. But we do fund, you know, sales models and traction and in places it can go. And so part of our work that we do is, like Molly mentioned, we sit down a lot with the entrepreneurs and we hammer on that. We really talk through all the different situations and we pull other people in and look at how we can improve that. If we don't fund you, you should at least walk away better knowing how to execute your business. If we haven't done that, we haven't done our jobs in this community, and it's really a disservice for sitting down with you as an entrepreneur and taking up your time as far as we're concerned. There's a lot of details we can dive into, but if there's a quick question, I'll answer it now, or we can, you know, dive into it later after. Yeah.
How important are you looking at profit? And we have up here from investors to bankers. I think that's a very good distinction of what you're looking for in numbers in the different stages they're growing. And you did a great job on the debt convertible note at the beginning. If you don't know your value, but as you're going, are you looking for profitable or are you looking for growth and then reinvestment?
Yeah, so GoodWorks operates as an impact investment fund. We're not a traditional VC fund. We are a family office. And so we're looking at how do we create the most impact in the borders of Montana or in the sustainability space, so or in social economics. So we're reaching out across the borders for different deals like that. For us, our focus, we lean 90% on a sustainability of your financial model and not looking at the growth. We're what's considered an evergreen investor. So it's more of a, in the sense that private equity will buy and hold for an extended period of time, that's how we operate. We're not looking for the 3 to 5 year flip at a 10X. That's not our model, that's not what we're looking for. So we're in a lot of ways non-traditional in that sense, and it's fun. We get to do things differently, but other investors will have different questions than we have.
Probably another question. How do you estimate the value of a company or estimate the potential value of a company?
So what we're looking at, you know, we're doing that with really every financing round because in terms of where we're putting that limit is where are you going to be 18 months from now given a certain amount of sales? And what's reasonable? You know, is it reasonable for the majority of companies that we're financing to have a $10 million limit on a, you know, their Series A or their seed series? No, they're going to be in the 2 to 5. Plus, it's how do you benefit your early stage investors enough and create value for getting in when it was riskier? I mean, clearly, the earlier the capital, the more risky it is. And what happens with a lot of the traditional VC market is your early investors get diluted out, and they really don't get anything at the end. It's your mid-market Series A investors, Series B investors that take the majority of the financing. So how can you, if you really want to build a growth company, it's how can you protect your early investors, knowing that they're going to get diluted down the road? So provide them, you know, a $500,000 cap if you're really early on and you don't have a lot and you know that you're going to get your first couple customers, or reach it out to $1 million. In terms of equity financing rounds, usually we're not leading those. So we don't actually ever lead those in a seed series or a Series A. We're coming to the table with somebody else. And so the majority of that's already hashed out. And we're deciding whether or not it's acceptable to us and we want to play in that round. So it's, you know, when you start talking about sales transactions, you know, we're working with a company right now where we're valuing it for a private equity company to acquire. And the paper value, if you run it out using traditional models, is worth about half of what the sales value is. However, there are 2 years of sales revenue goals that have to be hit for that to be carried through. So there's a million ways to run finances. It's that everybody on both sides of the table can agree upon the terms and that you've seen kind of where this runs out and how it plays out for everybody.
Banking itself is not complicated. The most important thing to remember with banking is we are not investors. And so when you're looking at your banking relationship, the bank's looking for two things, basically. We want to get paid back, and we want interest. So if you always are remembering that, then you're going to remember and you're going to know that profitability and sustainability are extremely important to a lending institution. So if you have an idea and you think I need $25,000 to get this off the ground, you write a business plan, don't go to a bank for the money. It's not going to happen because that's not what a bank or a lending institution does. If you're 9 years, 5 years into your business, and you've moved it through these levels that we've been talking about, and you're ready to expand or grow, you need a new piece of equipment, or you need to cash flow through a certain situation of receivables, or you need to buy some inventory to move you to the next level, that's where bank comes into play. It's risk reward, basically. Banks are low risk, low reward for themselves. So if you're keeping in mind that the access to capital from a lending institution is probably further down the road in an entrepreneurial relationship than in the beginning, then that's an important distinction to make. It does not mean that you don't keep a bank involved and engaged in the very beginning. And what I mean by that is you want to start establishing that relationship early. You set up your banking account, your checking account, you manage it well. When you have problems or you're going to go overdrawn, you contact your banker, you say, here's the situation. Bankers don't like surprises. You probably have heard that a million times. We don't, because it throws off what we're doing on the backside, and we don't like to be kind of, we don't like our feathers ruffled, essentially. So if you maintain that relationship and are always in contact with your banker through that checking account, maybe you set up a small a credit card, or you set up the ability to take credit cards, you set up your online banking, and you're using your relationship with the bank in the right way, and they're able to see you grow through the different stages and that you manage those stages properly, then when the time comes that you need to move to that next level and you've had the 2-3 years of profitability, the seasoning that you'll hear about, and you're able to manage the ability to pay the bank back with a little bit of interest, that's when you go and talk with the bank. A lot of people say banks won't lend money unless you don't need it. If you're at the point of not needing money from a bank, then don't go to a bank for money. It's pretty simple. But more often than not, what you need money from a bank for is to kind of push you to that next, or to cover that period of time, like a line of credit, that period of time where you don't have the cash, but the cash is going to be coming. And you know it's going to be coming. So you buy your inventory, you sell the product, you're sitting on your receivables, but you still got payroll, you still got the lights to keep on, all those types of things. Your line of credit, access it, receivables come in, pay the line of credit off. Don't use receivables to move you through the next thing. You pay the line of credit off. That way it doesn't evergreen on you, and then you end up in a different situation. So there's all different levels and access to capital. Keeping your bank involved in the beginning and establishing a relationship with a bank lender is important. And it's important to have that communication from day one so that they know what you're doing, they know what your plan is, they know where you're headed with things. Banks like to work with small businesses. I love to work with small businesses because I learn a lot about what's happening in that world. I may not be able to lend to you right away, but as I grow with you and as I understand your business, it's a lot easier for me to lend to you down the road. I'm not lending to your business, I'm lending to you. And that's an important thing to keep in mind as well. So the relationship developed with your banker is extremely important, even though they may not be able to get you access to money right away. Down the road when you need it for that next level, we're not looking for a piece of the company. We're not looking for the kitchen sink. We're just looking for our principal back and a little bit of interest. And that's when we come into play on the other things. In the meantime, you work to get the other access, and we'll put you in line with those types of things just as easily. Sit down with your lender and you say, here's what I need, and we'll talk to Montana, Idaho, CDC, we'll talk to MEP, we'll get you in touch with people and say, they're not quite ready for bank lending, but they're ready for this type of financing.
Well, and John, you bring up a good point. Would you touch on that a little bit? I think when I'm dealing with entrepreneurs all the time, I ask them, well who's your banker? And they'll say, First Interstate Bank. And I go, no, who the name? Well, I don't know. I don't have one. And it's often, you need to have one. You need to develop a relationship. And you need to interview them like you were interviewing somebody on your own team, right? They're going to be with you in the struggles and in the high points and the low. And, I mean, I would be very comfortable going to John and saying, here's my business idea. What do I need to look like 3 years from now for you to bank me? And John will tell me.
John, maybe you can talk a little bit about, because I think what you've said and what we've talked about mostly is probably startups where they're dealing with kind of innovative ideas. It's a software business. The model is somewhat uncertain. But we also get quite a few people on the launch pad that have more sort of traditional businesses, kind of coffee shops, bars. So, for example, one of our favorite clients is the Dram Shop. But they came in kind of 2 years ago and said, hey, we've got this idea for a dram shop, essentially a bar. But we helped them with put the financial model together, made introductions to the banks. And, I mean, they did get bank loans because there was kind of collateral. Can you maybe just talk a little bit about those instances where some of those more traditional business models can get funding off the bat?
Yeah, it goes a lot. One, to as you mentioned, there is collateral piece to it. Banks really don't want collateral. If you think of collateral, basically it's a hammer more than anything else. All collateral does for a bank is it gives us the position to be able to say, well, if you don't pay us back, we'll take this. We don't want this because then we have to do something with it. So really what we want is just the money back. But yes, in certain situations, there's way that you can put financing together, but it typically will flow down to that family friend type of thing. So if you come in that situation, I'm going to look more towards what collateral out there do I have. Home equity is typically the first thing that comes into play. So people will mortgage their home to get the money to invest in the business. It's not a bad way. It's just a different way. And it's a different way to get financing at a little less expensive. But there's typically got to be some outside source of revenue because the bank wants two things. It wants its money back and it wants interest. So you have to show in some way or form the ability to do that. Now, banks will take a little bit of a flyer on the projections that you have if there's a reasonable projection. And if they don't pan out, then there's a backup. We like primary, secondary, tertiary. I mean, we look at it all to find out how we're going to get paid back because we don't want the collateral. Sometimes collateral, secondary. So in weaker ones like that, we may go to Montana, Idaho, CDC. We may go to the Small Business Administration. And we get back-end guarantees from the Small Business Administration to help with those types of things. But they have their own rules and things that they're looking for as well. So there are ways to get financing if you're willing to literally put up the house. Or you have some back-end guarantees that are willing to step in and say, I'll take the place of them if it goes bad. So there are ways to do it. You just have to be willing to meet those ways. In some cases, you give up equity. It starts in debt, and you give up equity in the business. Sometimes you don't want to do that, so you bootstrap it. You eat Top Ramen noodles, and you move through the years. Other times, you look to family and friends. You look to your home. You look to assets you might have outside that you're willing to put up in place of. It's there. You ask the question, come with an idea, come with a solution, and then it's a discussion point at that.
Questions?
There must be some.
So I think one of the things that Molly demonstrated on all of her phases is she just kept asking people for help. Why don't you talk a little bit about that a little bit further? You just were so passionate that you were right on your idea that you were going to find any resource to make it happen. Describe your thinking.
That is an excellent question. I'm from the Midwest. I'm from a German immigrant family. We are hard workers. But my dad started a real estate company when he was 20. My mom was 19. They got married. My mom had $3,000. She had six siblings. Her dad died when she was 6 years old. I don't know how my mom had $3,000 when she got out from high school. They got married. They bought a duplex. My dad started a real estate company. He ended up putting my three brothers and I through college. We didn't even know we were put through college till the day we graduated. We all thought we were graduating with like $80,000, you know, in debt. He's an amazing businessman and entrepreneur. So then I have this one brother in the IP space who's working with businesses. My other brother is an entrepreneur as well. I think part of it is that's how I grew up, right? I was the youngest. I had two big brothers. We all were expected to perform at a certain level. And in our family, 8 hours of the day was for family, 8 hours of the day was for work, and 8 hours of the day was for community. I mean, I know that's kind of crazy because when do you sleep and eat? But the fact of the matter was, it was okay to ask for it, but you also give it back. So I'm comfortable asking because I also know I give a lot too. I'll mentor in different situations and, you know, donate when I can. And so I grew up that way. It was just like you did the hard work and it was okay to ask. But to, like, ask when you like really know what you need and when you need it. So I think that was part of it. It wasn't flippantly asking. Also, I really believe in my product, and I think people believe in me. I've been in town for 18 years. I've been very successful in my other careers. I do what I say I'm going to do. I deliver. So I think there's been some of that also. But some of the asking, too, then I didn't want it. Like, Paul knew this summer I was struggling with what we were going to do for money, and we wanted to build out a new website and a demo video and an app and some new features. And so he was trying to introduce me to some potential investors. And that at one point years ago, Dawn and I were talking, and part of the reason I said no to Dawn then was I had just found out I was pregnant with my second child, and I was like, well, I only have one 10X right now. This is a baby, not someone else's money. So I was also really comfortable saying no. I think that's part of it too. Like, I'm really comfortable asking for help because I'm also really comfortable saying, oh, no, thanks. That's not the right help for me. So I said to Paul, how do I know if I want to like take this guy's money? And he was like, well, you need to go out for lunch. It's like investor dating. I think that's what you said to me. Like, would you want to be in business with this person like you are in business with Colin? Like, would you feel good about that? And actually, I would have felt good about this person, but it just wasn't like the right time and good fit. It wasn't what I wanted. It wasn't what he wanted. But learned a lot about myself and what I would want. So I think part of asking is sometimes like, oh, I'm so stymied and confused, I need help, I'm not sure what, and then you find a mentor who kind of walks you through it, and then you find out what you want, and then they can refer you to the right thing. I think part of asking is being real comfortable. Like, when you apply for a job, you don't have to say yes to the job offer, right? So if you apply for money, you don't have to say yes to the money. You have to be comfortable saying no, also. And you have to be willing to be vulnerable, a little bit vulnerable about it.
You reminded me of something. People often say you ask for money, you get advice, you ask for advice, you get money. But I think that's a good way to look at it, sort of advice and money at the same time and having these conversations. So it's, I think, if there's one thing to take away from this panel, it's like there isn't a single answer here. There isn't a roadmap. There are lots of different options, and different businesses and different stages of business have different options to them. But talking to the different options out there helps you understand kind of what is going to be a good fit and when is that going to be a good fit for you. And that includes, for example, talking to banks kind of way ahead, both to build a relationship, but also, particularly if you're a first-time entrepreneur and you're moving into this world for the first time, bankers know what those numbers should look like. So they're going to be telling you your numbers look ridiculous, so there's no way they're going to be, they don't think you've got much chance, or you've really got your assessment of margins, for example, is just nowhere near what the sort of the industry average is. So this is a learning kind of educational process as much as it is getting to that outcome of kind of, okay, somebody's given me the $100,000 that I wanted. So I think really get out there and have those conversations and evaluate your options so that you know, because your business as well may go in a different direction to the one you thought it would. So the funding needs that you have may change and the funding options that are open to you may change.
Well, and I think that the models change over time, too. I can remember Paul and I were having this conversation a week or two ago. When I first started doing some equity investment 15 years ago, every time I saw a subscription model, I just hated it. It's like, oh, my God, I hate that. Today, if I saw any business plan that did not have a subscription model, I'd say, why is there not a subscription model? So you have to understand who your target is and what they think about things, and what our model was 10 years ago is different. And I think the theme that we're trying to keep saying over and over and over is just ask people, help them validate it. I see that our speaker from yesterday, John Hagmeier, has snuck into our room. He, for those who didn't have the chance to meet him or listen to him yesterday, really started with nothing as a school teacher. He had a business idea, had no really business acumen. He was very successful, grew a very successful company. I mean, I think his theme that he's shared with the community over the last 2 days is kind of an accidental entrepreneur, but also thinking big or thinking bigger. Because of his success, he and his wife have now gone into a position that they can help invest into companies. And so I'd ask you, what does a company look like for you two to get your money? What do you need to see to get your money? And they're looking for Montana investments.
I would tell you what, people have asked, what do we look for? Kaya's answer was, we are all different. So if you take, I'd say, First Interstate to Kaya, to us, we're all looking, in a sense, differently to invest at different points. Just on a side note, Kai and I got on the phone for an hour. He's working with a company in Virginia Beach. He asked if we would connect with him, Matt Mahler and I, my best friend. We did, drove 10 hours back and 5 hours back and forth to Virginia Beach and are mentoring those two people, and it was all connected through the Missoula, starting with the Missoula Chamber to Kaya. And this is no joke, this is the way the world works now, right? And so what we look for, we are looking for a recurring revenue model, or being able to get over to the subscription, the recurring. We want to see recurring model. We're looking for now, and we're open, we're on a spectrum, but what we're really looking for is anywhere between $1 million to $5, $6, $7 in recurring revenue, and you're looking for your CRO. This is a great, great description Kaya did from the debt financing to the Series A. We want to do the Series A. And from that point, and it's just not, we don't want to give somebody money. We also want to give them guidance. We want to give them banking. We have banking relationships that we've built that we can open up for people. All those different things, mentors, all that's what we want to bring. So we're looking for people like that and ideas like that. And we're not looking at any specific, like Virginia or New York or nothing. It is, we're looking for just great companies. And as we go around and speak, and I'm sure at some point I'll receive an email from Missoula saying, hey, I think we're ready, would you be interested in looking, and so that's how you do that. But that's, we're looking for great people, that's another thing, and not ideas. I've heard a lot of great ideas, but I've met very few great people in the world, and so we're always looking for great people. That's kind of what we look at. The banking relationships are so, to me, are just so important. I didn't understand that when I first started, and it's really good. I don't know how lucky you guys know what it's nice to have a panel like this up here to tell you. I didn't get any of this. I didn't have any of this. I didn't have a toolkit on our chamber that I could go up and look at. We didn't have that. I didn't know how important it was that Scott LaFell was my banker. I didn't understand that. And so it's really good. I want you guys to know. You guys are very lucky to have this, but we would be that next, not the evergreen, but we would be, we might do that. Like, let me just say this. Kai called me and go, John, what do you guys think about throwing, I'll say, $50,000 into doing something over here or something like that? And I would say, absolutely, that might fit us for just to start building a relationship. So, but our main thing is we're looking for recurring models, or being able to go to recurring models. And anybody that's looking to take, I would say $1 million to $10 million in investment capital to go from there, to grow your company.
Yes?
I just wanted to say a couple of quick things. First of all, thank you for your lunch talk. I went back at my staff meeting today as the CEO of our startup and just led with, I went all in, and when I hired all of you, you went all in, and thanks. We just had sort of an all-in moment today, so thank you for that yesterday. It's not always about asking for money like you're looking for actual dollars in a bank account either. Sometimes it's, James, I'm trying to sell my license in Boise. Your family lives there. Who do you know? Or Billings is the last major city in Montana where we haven't sold a calendar. Who's in economic development in Billings? Like, sometimes it's because you just need more customers too, right? I mean, that's money. That's money on the bottom line also. So you have to be smart about what you're asking for. Just to kind of touch over on that. And the final thing I want to say is we have someone from Roanoke, right? Yeah, here. So there's money in Montana, like Virginia money wants to come to Montana. It's like you can find the money.
Did you have a question?
I did. I don't know if you have time to answer it. Sure. Is it Kyle, or for any of you, really? Is it Kyle? Or
Kyle.
What is a specific example of a pitch that you had in the recent past that you can share with us as people learning how to pitch all the time? Obviously, we're out there trying to pitch as much as possible to practice.
So it's, we don't do as much like pitches per se. Are you looking for like tools and ways to pitch your business? Is that what you're looking for? So really how most of them starts are either through an intro via somebody we know, or we meet them at Hellgate Venture Network, or, you know, go down the list. It's some sort of personal connection. We get stuff through our website, but it's all really strange people from somewhere else and just super random. You know, they're throwing Hail Marys. So it's, you know, it's through a network at some level, and we sit down and we have a conversation with you, and really it's, tell me about your business. And you know, every investor is going to operate differently. We just sit down and have a conversation to learn about you, your business, what your history is, why you're doing this, and really where you want to take it. You know, that, and it ends up being a series of conversations, a series of email exchanges with information, and it generally takes a while. Like, it takes a while because we're not okay with something, and, you know, go run these numbers, figure out how you're going to get from point A to point B, or, you know, you realize that you need to spend more time working on your revenue model or your sales structure. There's a myriad of reasons why it's going to take a long time, but it's really, from our perspective, a very conversational, all right, let's learn. It's you're not pitching us on why you're the next, you know, $50 million exit, you know, or even $100 million exit. We're coming from a different perspective. So whereas, you know, John wants to invest in a round that's between $1 million and $10 million, and that's what he wants to hear. So it's understanding from somebody who's actually had a conversation also with that, or, you know, you can always go to most investors' websites and see who their portfolio companies are, or you can go to angel.co or Crunchbase, and if they're larger, and see who their portfolio companies are and really learn, you know, and call one of them up. I mean, try and talk to somebody who's talked to them before and learn a little bit about them and do a little homework to see what type of an investor they are, so you can have a more intelligent conversation around what matters to them.
And we do have an example of how to put a pitch deck together on our website, on MissoulaPartnership.com. but Kai's right. The entire point of a pitch is just to get someone like him to say, I want to learn more, or I want to hear more of what you're doing. That's it. And so, again, it's practicing what's your story over and over. So, boom, that's what it is.
The other good resource, I mean, I echo both kind of Kai and James's comments. Guy Kawasaki, who's a serial investor. He has The Art of the Start, The Art of the Pitch, and his 10, 20, 30 video is outstanding. It's like 2.5 minutes long, but it's essentially what he's saying in your pitch. You don't have to be true to this verbatim, but it's essentially 10 slides. So and there's some stuff online. If you look it up, it'll take you through the 10 sort of pieces of the story, but it's 10 slides, 20 minutes, and 30-point font, which is probably my favorite piece of it. And if you look at 30-point font on PowerPoint, you realize that's like 2 words. And his point about it really, I mean, he has a great analogy about actually kind of take the age of the oldest person in the room and halve it. So unless you're dealing with 16-year-olds, don't use the 8-point font. But his real point is, by not putting lots and lots of words on your slides, it means you actually know what the heck it is you're supposed to be talking about, because you don't want to read off the slides. So his pitch deck will give you a good structure, but really you should internalize that so that you have the 30-second version, the 3-minute version, the 10-minute version, the 20-minute version if you're doing that kind of formal pitch, but you need to internalize that story to be able to say, what's your value proposition? What's the market? How are you going to make money? What's your secret sauce? What do you need? What's your team? That you have those things kind of in your head, and you're quick to be able to, when you sit down and have that conversation, the conversation may not go in the order of the 10-slide pitch deck, but you know what the key points are that you're trying to get across.
Do we have maybe one final question? If not,
where's the beer?
The panelists will be here for the next hour or so. Hellgate Venture Network is hosting their annual meeting right after this, and so they're all available for individual questions. And at this time, I'm going to turn the microphone back over to John Horner, who is our sponsor for today's event, First Interstate Bank. And thank you, John, and thank you, panelists. I think you provided terrific information.
Yeah, they just asked me to say a few quick words. And I'll be really quick. Thank you all for coming. This was a great couple of days, and we definitely appreciate John coming and his lovely wife, who basically has taken care of him through all of this time. And we've learned that that's extremely important as well. But thank you all. Stick around for the social. If you have questions, just ask. And as John said yesterday, know what you don't know, and don't be afraid to ask the question. So have a good night.